Good evening, everyone. Welcome. My name is Mark Clancy, and I work at Metrolinx as the Senior Manager of Community Engagement for the Ontario Line Subway. I would like to welcome everyone to our information session this evening, where we will provide an overview of upcoming construction activities near the intersection of Queen Street and Spadina Avenue at the two sites which will become the station entrances to the new subway. Before we begin, I would like to take a moment to acknowledge, if you could please go to the next slide, please, there. Take a moment to acknowledge that we are on lands that have been and continue to be home to many Indigenous peoples, including the Anishinaabe, the Haudenosaunee, and the Huron-Wendat peoples. We are all treaty people. Many of us have come here as settlers, as immigrants, or involuntarily as part of the transatlantic slave trade in this generation or generations past. We acknowledge the historic and continued impacts of colonization and the need to work towards meaningful reconciliation with the original caretakers of this land. We acknowledge that Metrolinx operates on territories and lands covered by many treaties that affirm and value the rights of Indigenous communities, nations, and peoples. We understand the importance of working towards reconciliation with the original caretakers of this land. At Metrolinx, we will conduct business in a manner that is built on a foundation of trust, respect, and collaboration. It is my pleasure to be the moderator for this evening's meeting, and my goal is to keep the event on time and to ensure your questions are answered as best as possible. Tonight's meeting is being recorded and will be made available on the Metrolinx YouTube page. There is a closed caption feature available to use, and you will need to enable that on your own device. This evening, I will be joined by some of my colleagues here at Metrolinx and the construction team that is building the subway in your community. I would like to warmly welcome the residents of 438 Richmond Street, whom I had the pleasure of meeting in person last week to understand your experience with the recent construction taking place, along with your concerns and questions. I would also like to take a moment to welcome our elected officials. I understand that MPP Glover has registered to attend this evening, and I would also like to welcome their staff who are joining us this evening. In advance of tonight's meeting, several questions have been received using the Slido feature on the Metrolinx Queen Spadina event page. If you submitted a question and you don't see that question, it's because someone else already submitted the exact question or a very similar question. This feature will remain open during the event. Tonight, our team will briefly present the construction details. After the presentation, we will take questions and respond to those questions in real time. We have scheduled about 1 hour for this evening's session, and there that will include the brief presentation and the question and answer portion of tonight's session. Next slide, please. So I would like to turn the mic over to my colleague, Daniel Cicero. He's the sponsor for the Ontario Line at Metrolinx. Daniel.
Hi, good evening, everyone. I'm Daniel. Thank you, Mark. And I'll be taking you through just a quick presentation to give you an overview of the Ontario Line project. You can go to the next slide, Ross. Yeah, so you probably know, you've probably heard of it, and especially because it's really close to where you live. The Ontario Line is a new rapid transit line being built in the city of Toronto. It's a 15.6 kilometers long subway line that will cross the downtown and go north on Pape all the way to Thorncliffe Park area. It's encompassed of 15 new stations, all the way from Exhibition Station to station in Eglinton and Don Mills. The trip, once it's completed, will be less than 30 minutes, very likely less than 30 minutes from one end to another. And really what I want to highlight about the Ontario Line and all the benefits that it's going to bring, aside from easier, faster transit and transfers around the city, is it's going to also create a lot of connectivity with existing transit lines. The Ontario Line is designed to connect the city infrastructure network that we have right now, especially at the key lines. So we will be connecting at Exhibition Station with GO Transit Service, the Lakeshore West Service. The Ontario Line will also connect with Line 1 at DTC at Osgoode and Queen in the downtown. And if you keep going, you can kind of see it on the map. If you keep going kind of eastwards, it will connect to East Harbour in the Lower Don area and a brand new station there in the Smart Track Station with the GO Service, Lakeshore East Service. And it will also connect at Pape Station, a very important connection then that would help create relief for Line 1 at Pape Station with the Line 3, TTC Line 3. And finally, it will, as you head north on the line and the pink section of the line, which will be elevated, it'll connect to the future Crosstown, Eglinton Crosstown LRT Line 5 station at Eglinton and Don Mills. And so that's at a high level, the Ontario Line. If you go to the next slide, I'll give you a quick overview of this particular station that we're talking about today. So Queen Spadina, as the temporary name alludes to, is at Queen Spadina. That name we'll talk more about the name in the future as we work towards developing that with the community. Will create a huge relief for the streetcar network. It will be an opportunity for users of the popular 501 and 510 streetcar service to unload or load from the Ontario Line to those streetcar services. Ultimately, just creating more connections and opportunities for people to transfer into other services. The station will have two new buildings, one in the northeast corner and one in southwest corner, as you've seen on the screen here, and with the white squares, which will have multiple small entrances. And ultimately, the construction, we'll walk you through it in the next few slides, but I think just at a high level, it's important to note that during the time of construction, the intention is to not have any significant impacts to the existing services, the streetcar services on both Queen and Spadina. The work will be concentrated in those sites where we're doing the construction. With just some minor exceptions as it relates to construct to accommodate some particular parts of the construction. So if you could go to the next slide, Ross, thank you. And here is kind of to wrap the idea of the construction here at Queen Spadina. You see, this is a concept of what the station may look like on the southwest corner. As you can see, it will be fairly comfortable entrance for a significant amount of transfers from the streetcar and also for walk-ins where individuals are living in the neighborhood. If you go to the next slide, thank you, Ross. And now on the left-hand side, you're actually seeing the same entrance in the southwest corner. And in the far right side, you're seeing the northeast entrance, which is actually the current heritage building facade being maintained and converted into the station. The large part of the corners of the station will be converted into the station. And you can kind of see the entrance will be right at the corner for that station head house. And with that, I'll hand it over to Luis San Francisco. They'll take us to the construction activity. You got it?
Thank you, Daniel.
No problem.
I don't know if my camera is working, but okay, I'm going to start. So we can go to the first slide. So my name is Loïs. I'm part of the Queen Spadina construction team, and I'm going to give you some dates. So on Queen Spadina South, the demolition is done. We are going to start the piling. The piling will start at the end of January, and will go up to May. The demolition and heritage works is ongoing on Queen Spadina North. The piling should start in March up to June. After the piling works, we will do the excavation. So from April to October, between the two shafts. And after the excavation of the shaft, we will start the excavation of the cavern. So from October to early 2025. So that's the main dates for the two shafts for this year and the next year, we can say. So we can go to the other slide, Ross. So piling works. The piling is the next big activity on the south shaft. So the piling is a foundational technique which ensures stability and support for the buildings and infrastructure during the construction of station and subway structures. It's a temporary structure. So it's used until the permanent concrete structure of the station is done. We call this type of foundation second pile wall due to the overlapping of the piles. Thanks to this overlapping, we can assure good watertightness. So if you look on the first picture, we can see the typical form of the second wall with the pile and the overlapping of the pile. Some of the piles will be reinforced with steel profile. It's part of the structure of this temporary structure. We can go to the next slide. So methodology. So in order to do this work of piles, we are going to use drilling machine. So the picture is a picture of a drilling machine. We use this type of machine to drill hole. So in our case, we will create a 17 to 20 meter deep hole all around the perimeter of the site of the shaft. So this is equivalent to about a 7-story building. Once we drill the hole, then we pour concrete in the hole, and if it's a structural pile, we add a steel profile before pouring the concrete. The second piles are often used in a urban setting with confined footprints for construction. That's why we use it here in the north and the south shaft. We can go to the next slide. So here is a picture of a 3D picture of the south shaft. So this will be the installation during the piling. So here we can see the drilling machine along Graffiti Alley. It's a Bauer BG28 we are going to use to drill the piles. We can also see a mobile crane which is used to set up the steel profiles and to organize the site. We can see it on the picture, but we will also have concrete pump, concrete trucks when we pour the concrete, and the trucks for the steel deliveries and material deliveries. We will also have some excavators and loader to manage the site and the works. So here it's a picture of the works, the configuration of the works we will have on the south. So we can go to the next slide. So pile drilling at Queen Street West and Piling Avenue. So as I said before, we are going to start the piling on the south shaft. We start with the north wall, so along Green Street, Queen Street West, sorry. The work estimated from the end of January to the end of May for the south shaft. For the future North Station south site, the work estimate is from March 2024 to June 2024 for the piling. The expected hours of work are weekdays from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. and also Saturdays. For the south shaft, we plan to work 2 Saturdays per month at the beginning of the works. The crew required to park inside of the project limits or in allowed public parking spot to reduce the noise we can make during the works. So we can go to the next slide. Thank you. So pile drilling at Queen Street. During piling work, community members can expect. So we will have several machines. So drilling machine, excavator, concrete trucks, mobile crane. We will also have several trucks for the deliveries, for the removal of spoiled soil, for the concrete works. We will have some lane closures. So on Queen Street West and also Graffiti Alley for the south shaft. And we will have flagmans on site to ensure safety for the community and workers on the entrance and the exit of the site. You can expect noise from equipment drilling machine and the excavating materials during the delivery of steel beams and also during the concrete works. We will have minimal vibration and dust during this phase of work. And for the noise and vibration, we'll have monitoring devices installed to ensure safety and monitoring noise level during these operations. Ross, you can go to the next. Thank you. So pedestrian access and truck routine. So this is a picture of the south side configuration. So we can see, as you can see, we will have a clear road for the trucks to avoid backup and also to reduce the noise. The entrance will be on Queen Street West and the exit on Spadina Avenue or Graffiti Alley. We will close a lane on Queen Street West to store trucks and to have more room for the site. Graffiti Alley will be partially closed during the works, normally during the day, and the access will be maintained for the garbage truck and the local traffic. We will also have a flag person at the entrance and the exit of the site to ensure pedestrian safety and direct truck traffic. Ross, we can go to the north. Okay, so this is the north, it's for the north shaft. So we can see the installation of the north shaft and the road track. We will also have a clear road for the trucks with an entrance from Spadina Avenue northbound and an exit on Boulevard Street. Like that, we avoid backup and reverse for the truck, so it's better for safety and noise. Pedestrian access along Spadina Avenue will be under the building retention tower we are installing now. The sidewalk on the south side of Boulevard Street will continue to be partially closed as now during the demolition works. The parking lane on the east side of Spadina Avenue, northbound, will remain closed as now also. And we will also have a flag person to ensure the pedestrian safety and the direct truck traffic, same as in the south shaft. Plus, we can go to the next one. Construction mitigation, maybe Francisco, if you want to ask on this. I don't know if Francisco can hear us.
I was just going to be here available to respond to questions in the Q&A session.
Okay. I'm going to. Okay, thanks. Okay, Ross, we can go. So reduction impact. So to reduce impacts to residents and businesses in the area, mitigation will be in place. So including noise and vibration monitoring site, in place on site and in the neighborhood, in order to track the impact to ambient noise level. Truck and equipment will drive on top of a granular platform to minimize dust. If you see now the south shaft, we already completed the platform with granular. So this is this type of platform we are going to use to minimize the dust. And in order to preserve this platform in warmer and dry month, water will be spread to help with dust. And also adjacent road will also be cleaned once excavating material is starting to be hauled off. So normally during the first month of February, we will clean the road around the south shaft. The daytime, as I said, the daytime work hours for current phases of work is from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. Continuous loop truck routes, reducing needs for trucks to reverse using backup alarm. That's why we use a clear entrance and exit to avoid backup and reverse for truck. And the site ordering where possible to help reduce noise. So we will install specific ordering to reduce as much as possible the noise.
Mark Clancy, would you like to join us?
Yes, thank you. Thank you so much for the presentation. I know that was quite a bit of information. What I'd like to do at this point is open the meeting to questions that you may have. And you may have noticed in the chat, we've just dropped the link to the Slido feature on the event page. And that's where we welcome you to ask your questions. We want to keep all of the questions in the Slido feature on the event page. So please do not hesitate to drop your questions into the Slido feature on the event page using the link that my colleague has dropped into this chat for this meeting. You can also raise your hand if you have questions, and my colleague will allow you to unmute your mic. So just, when you put your hand up, just give it a second and we'll get to you to open the mic to answer your question. And I see that we have a hand up. And I'm just going to turn to Bradley. We have a question, a hand up from a few people in attendance tonight. And I will also take some of the questions directly out of our Slido question on the event page. So Bradley, if you could please unmute Steve.
Okay, Steve, your mic has been allowed. Please go ahead and unmute yourself.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Yes, go ahead, Steve.
Well, thank you for the presentation. I appreciate it. It sounds like you're doing
all of the underground work at this time. Well, you're starting the underground work, but the stations themselves have not yet been designed at this point. Or are you looking for input on the station designs?
That's a great question, Steve. Thank you for that. And maybe I will turn it over to Daniel to see if he's able to provide an update on the station designs.
Yes, so Steve, the station design is following design guidelines that have been agreed to or discussed with the City of Toronto. I'm not sure, sorry, maybe I missed some of the question here. If there's a specific question around what aspect of the design, we're happy to discuss it further, yeah.
Sure, yeah, just a couple of things. First is there doesn't seem to be a whole lot of sort of plaza space in front of these stations. I imagine they're going to be very busy. Queen Street sidewalks are already significantly overcrowded. People are walking on the street, you know, on nice days when there's lots of people out shopping. And this intersection is full of pedestrians. So I'm surprised there's not more space between this, the front of the station facade and the actual roadway. So that was my first concern. The second is I'm curious as to whether you're going to be looking at building housing or something on top of these stations, because I think there's a good opportunity here for transit-oriented development on top of these stations to provide more affordable housing for people.
Yeah, absolutely, Steve. Those are two good points. Yeah, I'll address the first one regarding plaza space and sidewalk requirements. That's absolutely something that we've been talking to the city about and we've accounted for. The stations will be, as you see them in terms of setbacks, but they've been modeled in a way and designed in a way that people will be able to quickly enter into the station. There's a sufficient lobby space, I'm going to call it, but it's basically a station space, as you can see, even in the image right now on the screen, that would accommodate and alleviate that crowding that you might feel on the sidewalk. So that is accounted for. It's absolutely something that we were very mindful at this station. And there are limitations as to why we couldn't put a plaza space in this at these locations. But we have done some, because we definitely looked into it, and we've done a modeling to confirm that it will be still acceptable. And to your second question around overbuild, that is actually the accounted for. The station is designed to protect for overbuild. It includes structural columns that you actually are seeing in the model as well, in the rendering that you see, concept rendering that you see on the screen. And if you're interested in to know more about the Transit-Oriented Communities program that Infrastructure Ontario is leading, they have already announced the intent at these two sites. Where we work closely with Infrastructure Ontario on it, and ultimately it will go out to the market for a developer to have the opportunity of building something above the station. And then we'll put the link, if it's not at the end of this presentation, but it will be through engageio.ca that you can learn more about the overbuilt possibilities on top of these two station headhouse.
And thank you so much for that, Daniel. And I'm just looking at the questions in the Slido, on the Slido page. And that is actually a very popular question. The development above the station buildings with appropriate housing. So there are plans, as Daniel indicated, to do that. And I see that we have a couple more hands up, so I'm going to go to the initials RKK. And Bradley, if you can work the mic there.
Yeah, KK, your mic has been enabled. Go ahead.
Thank you so much. Hi, my name is Christina. First of all, thank you very much for holding these sessions. It's very informative, and thanks for doing that for the community. Also very excited about this project to be happening. I do live directly at Queen and Spadina, so I'm going to be directly impacted and living with this change. So my main question is around the schedule. I saw that you are estimating completion in 2030, so that's 6 years, which, you know, it is a long time from now. My main question is, how confident are you in this delivery date of 2030? And what are some of the factors or risks that you're seeing for this to extend beyond that date? And what is your planning around that? I'm also asking that looking at other major transit projects in the city that have maybe had more of a delay than what was originally expected. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that question. And I will turn it over to one of my colleagues. Perhaps Lewis, you can respond to that question.
Yeah, thank you, Mark. So as you said, the end of the project is to be on 2030. So for now, the plan is still to be on time, and we don't see some difficulties for the moment to reach these dates. We share a schedule with Metrolinx, and the date is still 2030. I don't know if Metrolinx want to add something on that, but
maybe Luis, you can emphasize. Christine, I apologize. The important thing here is the station construction timeline.
Yeah, I can share the general timeline if you want. Like that, you can have something maybe more clear. So for us in construction, 2024, we are going to do the piling and the shaft excavation. So we are going to start the piling soon. And after that, 2025, we do the shaft and cavern excavation and also the cavern concrete works. So we do the concrete wall and all the lining of the cavern. And after 2026, the TBM should cross at Queen Spadina Station. We will also have the concrete structure work for the shaft. 2027, we will have the concrete structure work still ongoing, and also the architectural and mechanical electrical works. And after 2028, architectural and mechanical electrical works. 2029, also architectural and mechanical electrical works, urbanism finishes and commissioning, and after 2030, substantial completion. That's the general timeline for the project.
Yeah, thank you. I think you're going to get a feel for the first few years is underground works.
Yeah.
The last 3 years or so are all architectural and mechanical systems, yeah, or structural. And after that, they'll be commissioning. But I think and to answer your question around confidence, I think that's generally what we're driving towards. We're aiming for that timeline, at least for the station construction aspects here.
Yeah.
Thank you, Luis.
Thanks.
All right. Thank you for the question. And I'm going to go down the list. And I'm sorry if I pronounced this name incorrectly, but Sour Rush.
Yeah, Sarush, apologies. Your mic is enabled, so unmute yourself and go ahead.
Hi, thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Thank you for this meeting. I have one question. Do you need any employee and manpower about the survey engineering or geomatic engineer for this project, and where we can find about some information about it? Thank you.
Yeah, maybe I can answer that question. It's a good question. we do have a career section at metrolinks.com/careers, where we do post quite a few job opportunities. And we do also have a job fair on January 24th up in the Thorncliffe Park community. But I just want to preface that job fair is fully booked. We've had tremendous amount of interest and support. Bradley, if you can just mute, please. A lot of support and interest in that particular job fair. And we will be hosting additional job fairs as the project progresses. But for now, I think the best place is through our metrolinks.com careers page. Thank you for that question. And then the next name I have is Moggy. Please go ahead with your question.
Hello, are you able to hear me?
Yes, please go ahead.
So, I know some people who have expressed concern that because the tunnel boring machine is not in the ground right now, they're concerned that the completion date could be delayed. And so I'm wondering, when is the tunnel boring machine expected to go into the ground?
Great question. Lewis, can I defer to you to respond to that question?
Yeah, I can give you the date for that. I just can give you that the TBM should cross Spadina in station in 2026. But for now, I haven't got a clear date for the TBM. I can't give some date.
Yeah, Athaban, I don't know if you can add a little bit here, but just to give you comfort on, I know what you're getting at here, is the tunnel boring machine is all being contracted kind of in by the same contractor. Maybe you can add a little bit on what that looks like, Athaban.
Yeah, hi everyone. My name is Athaban. I'm the senior project manager for Metrolinks. The TBM, Luis is the project of the Queen Spadina station, so. The question related to TBM was probably more difficult for him to answer, but currently my understanding is that TBM is in procurement stage right now. We are starting the TBM, for everybody's information, starting at Exhibition Place. So as Luis mentioned, it's expected to come to Queen Spadina in 2026. The intent is to start the TBM works somewhere in time in 2025. And it is OTG, same contract. It's just going from one end to the other end.
Thank you for that. OTG, for those on the call, Stan, is the short abbreviation for the Ontario Transit Group. And they are responsible for building the subway in the downtown area of the project. So that's from Exhibition Station all the way over to the Don River in the east. And now I'm going to go over to, I believe it's Jay. Please go ahead with your question.
Can you hear me?
Yes, please go ahead.
Hi, yes, thank you. I guess my question is a two-part question. The first being technological. With the tunnel boring machines, I'm curious as to the depth of them around the King Bathurst, Queen Spadina area. As everybody knows, there's a barrage of condominiums with very deep parking concaves, some four or even five stories deep. And I want to know, you know, based on the route of the machines, you know, what is the proximity and I guess, you know, the noise, you know, factor for, you know, people, I guess, even in the parking structures when you get your car, you know, how deep are we talking about? Is it a deeper section here than in other parts of the line? So that is my first question. And my second question, I'm going to ask it right now, and then hopefully you could just answer both back to back, is what is being done to involve, I guess, the younger generation or the youth, specifically within the downtown core? There's a lot of youth, you know, within various communities. The one I'm thinking specifically is the Alexandra Park community, which is currently under revitalization. And this looks like a great opportunity, though I haven't heard anything of, you know, some type of cross collaboration between that community, the youth that reside there, and, you know, getting involved with a major infrastructure project that will essentially be a part of their community permanently once completed. So that is my twofold question.
Yeah, so that's like, those are great, two great questions. And maybe I can just touch on the latter part of your question, engaging youth in the community. And actually we are, I'm with Metrolinx, and we are just in the process of developing a youth engagement strategy. You know, just to some of the great points that you raised, there's a definite interest and momentum within our youth population who are avid transit riders and will be transit riders when the future Ontario Line subway is up and running. So we definitely want to engage with the youth community across the project to make sure that they are, you know, they have a voice and their views and opinions are understood and concerned. And maybe the first part of your question, I can turn that over to, I believe it's Athavan.
Hi again, it's Athavan again. So I think I understand your concern. I think it's a valid concern. The depth of the shaft is expected to be between 38 to 42 meters, so the bottom of the shaft, so well below the parking. It's going to be inside the bedrock. Having said that, there is going to be, just like the SOE, just like any critical activities, there is going to be vibration, et cetera, monitoring happening during that time.
Thank you for that.
Yeah.
Thank you. All right, and next is Sunil. Please go ahead.
Great, am I on?
Yes, hello. You are. Go ahead, please.
Thank you. So today, for the first time, I face north. I'm at 438 Richmond Street West, and I'm on a low floor. I smelt some carbon monoxide or just exhaust. There was a machine out in the where the station is, where it's been flattened, just cleaning up, I guess, some snow or whatever. Obviously, I mean, assuming these machines, this pile driller is going to be running on diesel or whatever, correct? And giving out exhaust.
Yes, maybe I can turn. I'm not sure of the exact equipment on site, but I'll have to rely on my colleagues from the Ontario Transit Group. Perhaps Lewis, you can respond to that.
The question is, what the drilling machine, is it a diesel machine?
Yeah, like, is it going to be giving out exhaust? I'm assuming it will be, because for the first time today, I smelt some exhaust, some carbon monoxide in my unit. I had the window open.
Okay.
And I just had to close it. That's all. I just want to know.
Yeah. All the machine on site will be on a diesel or a fuel machine.
Oh.
Hey, okay. Just to clarify also that point, there is air quality monitoring also happening on site. So,
correct.
If any issues that's raised, please let us know. But there is air quality happening as well.
All right, thank you for that. I'm just going to take a question from Slido. This is a question that we often get about the station name and what will the Queen and Spadina station be called once the line is complete. And some of you may be familiar with this approach and other projects that Metrolinx has been a part of, but there are opportunities for the community to provide input on some of the station names across the project. So the Queen, we refer to this as Queen and Spadina Station, and that is really a planning name that we've given the station just to help people orient themselves to the station location. So there will be an opportunity for the community to provide input on station names. There might be, and that might be through surveys, through a voting program, but we definitely do have plans to engage with the community to identify some of the station names. And now I'm going to go back to the hands and Soon Mote. I'm sorry if I've mispronounced that, but please go ahead with your question. Bradley, did you unmute?
Yes, Soon, your mic has been enabled, so please unmute yourself and go ahead.
Not hearing anything, so maybe we will come back to Soon. And I will go to Jackson. Please go ahead with your question.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, please go ahead, Jackson.
Yes, hi. Thanks for having this meeting and being transparent with the community for all the questions. Anyways, I'm just wondering, this is more like in the future, like it seems like the piling work is just kept to the building areas, but do you foresee in the future, like possibly during the tunnel construction, if there will be any significant road or sidewalk closures, such as like on Bay and Queen, where they had to close off the entire road? Because I'm just worried that might affect the businesses around the area. Yeah.
That is a great question, Jackson. And I'm just going to lean on, I see Athavan has come on camera. So Athavan?
I'll take this one on since it's not Queen's, but so it's a great question. The benefit of these stations as well is that, yes, we are going to keep it within our footprints. SOE, as soon as the SOE is done, all the excavation is going to happen within the footprint. The TBM's all underground. So there should be, there might be some minor closures here and there, but in reality, all of it will be within our restricted areas.
All right.
Answer your question?
Yeah. Yes. Thank you for that. And I'm going to just go back to the Slido because this is another question that we get asked often. And this question is related to noise and vibration from the construction activities. I know last week when myself and some of my colleagues met with many of the residents from the condo at 438 Richmond Street West, there were lots of questions about noise, vibration, how that's monitored. And so I'm just going to turn it over to Francisco to speak a little bit about how the noise and vibration is monitored to ensure there are safe limits during construction. And do you want to unmute yourself there, Francisco?
Here we go. Can you hear me now?
Yes, please go ahead.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Francisco Metcalf. I'm the environmental manager for OTG, the design and builder for the project. So specific to your question related to noise monitoring, we do have a noise monitoring program that is active during the whole construction process. Without getting too much into detail, what that entails is while construction is happening, there's going to be, those devices are already deployed. There are going to be a series of more noise and vibration monitoring devices installed and functioning, collecting real-time data throughout the work area. Now, these devices have telemetry capability, and that continuous noise monitoring or results that are picked up by the monitoring devices are transmitted to the project team when there is a tendency of exceeding a certain noise or vibration threshold, right? So once we get these notifications that we are getting ready to exceed these thresholds, we immediately get to work to understand what's going on at the project area. We have the ability to remotely also log into these devices and listen to what those devices are picking up to make a first initial screening exercise to determine if it's construction related, or maybe it could be background noise. Once we do that screening, we then actually coordinate directly with the construction team real time immediately to understand what happened differently that triggered these alerts. And then with the understanding of what's happening, then we kind of rethink our means and methods if required to keep those noise and vibration levels within the allowable thresholds. Hopefully that high level explanation of that monitoring program is answering the question.
Thank you for that. Really appreciate your response to that question. And I'm going to go back into the hands up feature here. And I see we have Laish. Please go ahead with your question.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for joining this meeting about this. My main question is regarding the access to Graffiti Alley. The notice shows closure of the Graffiti Alley that goes to Spadina Avenue, but I think you also mentioned throughout the presentation that it will be access for garbage trucks and local traffic. So if you can just clarify a little bit, how will that be done? Will people be able to allow to walk through that to visit Graffiti Alley as a tourist attraction? Just a little bit more information. Thank you.
No, that's a great question. And we have a similar question in the Slido chat. So thank you, Elish, for that question. And perhaps I'll turn it over to my colleague Lewis at the Ontario Transit Group to provide a response.
Yeah, thank you, Mark. As I said during the presentation, we will close Graffiti Alley, but the closure, we are going to close this part of Graffiti Alley during the day, and it's not like a big physical closure. We will have a flagman and maybe fast fence, and like that we can manage it, we can move it, and to leave access to the garbage truck or local traffic. But we will not permit the access to the visitor, for example, if there is people who just want to go through to visit this famous street, it will not be allowed due to a safety concern.
Thank you so much for the response, Lewis. And I'm just going to go to Sophia, Anne-Marie, please go ahead with your question. Anne-Marie, you may have to unmute yourself there. And please go ahead with your question. Anne-Marie, are you there? All right, maybe we will come back to Anne-Marie and we will go to Sophia. Please go ahead and ask your question.
Hi. Regarding the actual noise level, I know it says the monitoring, but that's just the monitoring. Has the builder applied for any exemptions or increases of the regular noise level that are allowed at that time of day, which I think is about 80 decibels? Can you just give us an idea of like how loud this piling would actually be in understandable terms, like compared to a jackhammer or a jet engine?
It's a great question, Sophia, and I'm going to turn it over to Francisco again. You just want to unmute yourself, Francisco?
Great question. Also tough to answer. Part of your question was, do we have, can we give an exact decibel level that you can expect from the feature of work that we're discussing? That is tough to give you an exact answer with a very precise number. However, one of the things that we have done is, when we were talking earlier about the monitoring program, that's more of a reactive kind of approach. So from a proactive perspective, what we have done is taken into consideration the different types of equipment and the specifications that these equipments have, right? The different receptors that are around the work area, and put it into a model. And that model gives us an idea of what predicted levels we can expect, and understanding what those predictions are, then we move forward to then try to, if those predicted levels are too high, what can we do to bring them below a threshold? I'm talking about mitigation, right? And when we talk about mitigation, we typically are talking about temporary noise barriers, things to that effect, or administrative controls, changing work times, where work starts and ends, et cetera. So in advance of starting those works, those mitigation features will be in place prior to the work start, so that would help prevent exceeding those levels, and then that monitoring program makes sure that things are happening like they should. And if for some reason something pops up that triggers an alert, we are notified, and then reactively to that alert, we shuffle things around and change things around to keep those noise levels under control. As far as what type of have we applied for any type of exemption or anything like that, everything related to noise and vibration is based on the levels that are allowed and considered in the contract. I'm not aware of any exemptions being requested from the city at this time.
And so our acceptable noise levels, Francisco, they are within the City of Toronto.
Exactly. Yes.
Noise levels, acceptable, yes. Noise levels. And just so, because I know that the piling can be quite loud, is there another type of machine that maybe we're a bit more familiar with that you could give as an example? Like, is that piling going to be as loud as a jackhammer? Is that possible, just so we can just appreciate what to expect when the piling begins?
I don't know. I think I'm going to have to lean on Luis to give us an idea. Generally speaking, if you compare piling with jackhammer, piling is going to be louder. But Luis maybe can expand a little bit better on that one.
Yeah, in fact, it's not the same type of noise, but the piling should be less than a jackhammer, okay? Because you know we did the demolition works, and during the demolition works you also can have a noisy works due to the demolition, and the piling is really not the same type of noise, So it will be okay noisy because it's like civil works, but it will not be the same noise than a jackhammer. I don't know, Francisco, if you want to add something, but
yeah, I think what Luis is trying to say is that when you look, when you consider or compare a jackhammer with a piling machine, you know, a piling machine are basically a huge machine that drives like a hammer, a device into the ground, right? Where so it's not a continuous thing, whereas a jackhammer is a continuous noise happening constantly while the jackhammering operation happens.
And also we need to keep in mind that during the pipe construction, we are not going to drill from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. Okay, we are going to drill the pile, but up at the moment we reach the bottom of the pile, okay, we stop the drilling, we install, for example, a steel profile, and after we pour concrete. So, you know, it's not drilling works from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. So we will have some noisy peak, if we can say, but during the concrete work and during the installation of the steel, it's less noisy than during the drilling works. So it's not like with the jackhammer when you start at 7 a.m. or no, not 7 a.m., but let's say 8 a.m. and you do jackhammer all the day. And it's really not the same.
All right. That was a great question. And thank you, both of you, for responding to that question. I know we are a little bit over our 1 hour time frame, but I know there's two hands left. So I'm going to ask Laura to go ahead with her question, and then we'll end with the last question from Soon. So Laura, please go ahead with your question.
I think my question should be pretty quick. The 2030 timeline, is that for the station only, or does that also include the condo above? And then if that's not the case, do you have any info on when we will find out about that residential building and the development of that?
So the 2030 timeline is related to the project that Metrolinx is responsible for, and that's the subway, and the construction of this station. The development above the station is on a different timeline, and that is being led by Infrastructure Ontario. I don't have the details. That would be best responded to by Infrastructure Ontario. And I see my colleague Daniel has jumped on camera. So perhaps, Daniel, you wanted to add to that.
Yeah. Thank you, Mark. Yeah, generally, the intention is for that work to happen immediately after the work is done. So, we're working closely with IO Infrastructure Ontario to make that a reality. But yes, the timeline is not defined yet. It will be Infrastructure Ontario will communicate that once we know better. And it won't be for a few years. Once there's a developer on board and all those steps are taken.
Does the subway station have to be completely done before that happens?
Yeah, the priority is to get the transit construction working and operational, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Great question, Laura. And last question, Soon, please go ahead with your question. Soon, if you can just unmute yourself there, and we'll take the last question of tonight. Soon, please go ahead. Not hearing anything from Soon. So maybe I will just take one more question, Anne-Marie. Please go ahead with your question. Go ahead, Anne-Marie. All right, I'm not hearing anything from Anne-Marie. I will go to the next person, Tristan. And Tristan, Please go ahead with your question, and this will be the last question for tonight's session. Tristan, please go ahead. If you can unmute yourself, Tristan. All right, we've lost microphone abilities for some reason, and I do apologize for that. And I do not want to keep us on longer because I know we've taken up quite a bit of your time this evening, but on behalf of Metrolinx and our colleagues at the Ontario Transit Group, I want to thank you very much for attending tonight's session and for allowing us the opportunity to provide you with an update on the upcoming construction activities at the future Queen and Spadina Ontario Line subway station. For those of you who perhaps have any questions for us, you can email those questions to us at ontarioline@metrolinx.com. We do have a telephone number available as well. You can register for the Ontario Line newsletter if you are not already receiving that. Please do go ahead and register for the Ontario Line newsletter. I also want to say that if there are questions in the Slido chat that we haven't been able to respond to, we will follow up with responses to those questions in the Slido chat. So once again, thank you so much for spending your evening with us. Take care. And this is not the one and only time you will be hearing from Metrolinx. We will be hosting more of these sessions in the future. And we will be in touch with you. So thank you very much and have a good evening.